It is really a very special occasion for me to have been given this opportunity to speak to you on this important occasion of the annual entrepreneur convention. I'm not an entrepreneur. I have been in the government. I have been elsewhere too, but not in entrepreneurship. So it's a new subject for me. And I must thank Amitabh Kant, who has just left, as having introduced us to the high and mighty of India, which is contained in this very large segment of startups. And this is a very important issue on this particular occasion of Entrepreneur Convention, because startups are now the largest number of entrepreneurs in the country, and my congratulations to all of them. And as Amitabh correctly pointed out, some may fail, but those who fail will come back again. So it's been a very, very unique opportunity. And this convention, as I said, is unique in many ways, as its participants, I am told, I understand, include not only successful entrepreneurs from the corporate and public sector, but also, as we heard, some startups, also startups, investors, government officials, and celebrated professionals from all over the world. I understand that the convention's agenda is tomorrow, today, how to think exponentially, if I understood correctly. It's also unconventional, as it covers not only the present state of the economy, but also how the future is unfolding in terms of new sectors, consumption trends, emerging technology, investment patterns, and growth prospects. There is simply no doubt that if you look at the title of this particular session or particular day session, is how to think exponentially tomorrow, today. I mean, there is really no doubt that what happens in the present, and this is very important, that what happens in the present and what the distinguished entrepreneurs are able to do today will shape India's future. This is the most important point that I would like to emphasize, and therefore, in this context, it is extremely relevant to have this entrepreneurs convention today, and I am delighted to be a part of it. Now, what I propose to do today, I mean, based on what I know a little bit about, is to talk to you about the current developments in the Indian economy and future prospects for what has been referred to as exponential growth. Amitabh Kant mentioned a great deal of things which are being done by the government, a great deal of measures, of number of measures which have been taken by the government to do the ease of, or to rather introduce the ease of doing business and so on and so forth. So I don't want to go over that ground. But let me just make it two or three critical issues that we should think about. Today, as it happens, for the first time, you'll be surprised, after 25 years, India has the advantage, and to do whatever you want to do, of having a government formed by a party which has a majority of its own. And it makes it feasible for the government to take the kind of measures which Amitabh talked about and to introduce further reforms as it considers necessary for the country over a long, long period. And this is extremely important, that we have the time, we have the opportunity, and we have the strength today to do what we want to do. India has one of the highest savings rates, investment rate. We have all the factors of production. If you look at labor, if you look at land, if you look at productivity, technology, for example, and we have all the resources for making India not only grow, but to alleviate poverty within a defined period. And I hope that the government will now had started already, introduced several basic reforms which had been pending for a long time. For example, just now, the introduction of GST across all states, which is perhaps one of the most significant reforms in India's economic history since independence. Then, Abhida talked about all the disbursement of central subsidies to the poor or cash subsidies through DBT, significant increases in public investments in infrastructure, increasing FDI inflows, wage reforms, and launching the so-called Digital India campaign. So if against this background today, you consider India's tomorrow and India's prospects of exponential growth over the next few years, I will mention that we also need a few basic reforms, not only changing the laws that we have or dropping the laws that we have, but India today needs some other basic reforms. And I'm getting into this because this is a somewhat different subject. What is basic reforms? And it is, to my mind, today, if you look at the past, we had as many as 9 governments in the last 25 years. Most of these governments, 6 of them had 1-year government. The other 3 were also coalition governments. And there were so-called compulsions of coalition to do basic reforms. And by basic reforms, I don't mean to reform what you already have, but to introduce new changes. And if you permit me, I'll just highlight a few of them, which are, to my mind, extremely important, which can be done, and which will give India a new startup, as it were, a new start compared with the colonial legacy that we have in many of our governmental functioning. So the first of all, we want to make India the new India, the new digital India, to make India the people's India, then it is most important, in my view, to redefine the political role of central government in policy making and administrative system. Political role of the central government in policy making and administrative reform, in administrative system, needs review. This basic reform, which is government should certainly take the lead in policy making, central government, and setting out policy priority. Of that, there is no question. Policies have to be made by an elected government. We today have a majority government in power, and what policy should be, what is important for our country, how we can alleviate poverty, how we can make startups start, and so on and so forth. Policies in all these respects must be made by the government. However, the political role of government in actual implementation of policy measures on the ground should be minimized. We don't need every ministry or every individual who is in power to have its own mission to implement the policy that has been announced. Our country, just think about it, India, 600 million people had fair and free elections. And nobody has accused the election authority of having corruption. How and why? Think about it. It doesn't have to report to the ministry. It is a mandate given by the people, for the people, and it has the ability to do what it has been entrusted in. UPSC, free and fair examination, tests, or whatever needs to be done, and some may not agree with exactly what they have done, but they don't have to report to the government. CAG, one of the most celebrated audit and account service India has. So why doesn't India have other authorities which can deliver? So my first point that I want to make is that we should And all these institutions that I mentioned to you are not the institutions which report to the government. There are certainly institutions which report to the government and also do very well. But why is it that our public sector enterprises are not doing as well as they should, and the net deficits in the revenues of these enterprises is dependent on government's budgetary support? But anyway, that's just one point. So we should, the implementation part, we have to delegate, and not the government ministries to do, but policy making, absolutely. Then, to my mind, now these are very major reforms, and this can be done only because we have a majority government in power. Another major reform is to rationalize delivery of all public services, all, through faster introduction of direct benefit transfers. Amitabh Kant was absolutely right that if that happens, that would make a lot of difference. But today, we have more than 60 subsidies for the poor, of which very few have been digitized so far. So we need to expand this network and digitize delivery of all services, and hopefully also combine many of these into one subsidy. And some suggestions have been made, some debate has been going on in the newspapers and so on about UBI and so on. But whatever needs to be done is that to how to avoid diversion of funds which are meant to be transferred to the poor. According to one study by Planning Commission several years ago, 48% of the food from the ration shops is diverted. Now, why does it happen? And we have to tackle this basic, these kind of basic issues. And we can do so today. Then it seems to me that another measure for exponential growth over a period of time, is decentralization by the central government of administrative and economic powers to state governments, and link the disbursement of budgetary funds, the Planning Commission funds or Niti Aayog funds for budgetary assistance to center, to budgetary assistance by the center to actual outcomes in different states. We have the Finance Commission, which allocates money to the states. That's fine, then the states can decide what they want to do with that money. But the central government, if it has to implement on the ground, it has to go through states. So the central government should also change the policy framework whereby the Niti Aayog and so on would disburse what his actual outcomes are in different states, and not based on certain other statistics, population, poverty, and so on. Why is it that you have so much diversion? Then, to my mind, and this is a very important point, it's also necessary to improve the functioning of parliament, which is frequently disrupted by multiple small parties, and also to ensure that members of parliament or MLAs with outstanding criminal cases against them are not allowed to take office until the pending criminal cases of such elected members are decided by the Supreme Court. Can you believe 20% of the MPs have criminal offenses which are pending? And some years ago, you would have seen an ad in the newspapers where somebody coming out of it say, I'd rather fight the election and be in politics than in jail. So you have to expedite the corruption part, the criminal cases, and so on and so forth. And that this can be done. And I'm going to the basic reforms, because all the nitty-gritty has been talked about already of what we can do under the present framework. But today that we have a government after 25 years, which has a majority of its own, which can do the basic reforms, and these are some of the things that can be done. I mean, you take the anti-defection law. It was very well-intended anti-defection law when it was done, because in Bihar, as you may remember, sometimes ago, 20 years or 30 years ago, the two parties were sort of negotiating because they didn't have a majority on their own. So some other members were negotiating with this party or that party, that which party to join, which would form the government and so on. So the anti-defection law after the Bihar issue was introduced. But what is anti-defection? It says, just think about it as an Indian, What it says is that if you are a member of a party and you leave that party, then you have to seek re-election. But if you are a party, then you don't have to seek re-election. You can leave the government or join the government or do whatever you want. Now, as entrepreneurs who are assembled here, you would know that there is an unintended, perverse incentive for leaders with 2, 3, 4 constituencies to have their own party. And that's why, if you look at all our states, if you look at our Lok Sabha until now, that you had many, many parties being elected with a fewer members. If you had 40 members, you'd be king out of 543. So what I'm saying to you is that there are some basic reforms which can be done if we did something with the anti-defection law, applied it to parties and not only to the individuals, then you will reduce fragmentation of parties, which our country needs. And I had talked about functioning of parliament, about which you everybody know. And similarly, finally, I would say that parliament must hold ministers responsible for performance and implementation of policies which have been announced in parliament for implementation. Now you just see there are questions and answers in parliament, and I had some experience having been nominated member of seeing the functioning, and I have written a book on that also. But it's one of the most interesting thing is that if you have a few members, the ministers would be asked questions. They would say, yes, we will do this, we will do that, something, something, you know. But then why it is not done, why it is not implemented, they would say that it is in the Public Accounts Committee or somewhere else. And if why it is not implemented, the center would say because the states are not cooperating. If you go to the states and ask them why is it not implemented, they would say that we are not getting money from the center, and so on and so forth. So I'm sorry to take your time, but what I'm saying essentially is that the fact that after 25 years, we have a majority government in power, which has done a lot, and the mission is really exemplary of the present government, that we need to understand and undertake certain basic reforms which would make India's democracy, which would make India's prospect for exponential growth, which would make India's poverty alleviation at a faster rate than what is happening now. There is a lot more that can be done, but I don't want to go into all this, and please forgive me for talking about exponential growth in a different way, in a larger framework, because after, as I said, that earlier the compulsions of coalitions are no more there. And even if you take unpleasant or even if you challenge certain vested interests, it can be done. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. In fact, it's always an honor to hear you. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to open the floor for questions, and we'll have the mics passed on to you. Please do raise your hands and do introduce yourself before directing the questions. We have a question from Ritu herself. Can we have the mic passed on to Ritu?
So wonderful address there. So just wanted to know, sure, you need to give a mic to him also. Yeah, okay, sure. Can we get the lights a little dimmer on the stage, please? Sir, so my question to you is that, you know, India has multifaceted problems. And then again, we also have a situation where we want to catch up with the world. We have a poverty problem on one hand, and then we have a problem which is to do with being on the world map and really be seen as a country which is going forward at a fast pace on the other. Now, how do you create a balance in a country like this, wherein, you know, you want to fight poverty, you also want to fight problems which is to do with making country literate, and then there's one side of India which wants to sort of build global organizations, they want to be the next Facebook coming out of the country. How do you create a balance in a country and, you know, make sure that everybody is, the best examples of countries we have seen in the world are countries where the middle class moved on further, there was always a middle class in that sort of country. Look at US, it's a perfect example, everybody's one. As a country, how do we become one? Why do we have so much desegregation? And how can growth be for everybody? How can it be democratic, really, in that sense?
This is a very, very important basic issue that you have raised. And I mentioned a few of these things which can be done. When you talked about the trade-offs, you know, we always say inflation and growth. That we can worry about a trade-off if inflation is high and we want high growth, we can't create more money. And the other way around, that if inflation is low, we can do things, you know. So there are trade-offs and so on, but they can be reconciled in our country, and you've asked a very relevant question, which I feel is that, which I believe that India today has the strength not only to grow at 8 or 9%, which everybody talks about, which Niti Aayog, the government talks about. I mean, today we have 7.1%, tomorrow we may have 6.1%, but that doesn't matter. The long-term prospects for growth are high. But how to distribute this growth in a way so that poverty can be alleviated? Why is it that India has the largest number of poor in the world, despite 70 years of development? The second five-year plan, which was launched in 1956, announced that poverty would be alleviated in 1980. And you ask yourself that today we are much stronger, much better off, both in terms of the resources which are required to alleviate poverty and all the technical help that is required to remove poverty. Why don't we do it? The answer, and the answer is simply that the authorities which announced they would alleviate poverty are not accountable for the performance and would always find excuses. These questions are asked in Parliament most of the time, that why are farmers dying today? Why are they committing suicide? So this is our responsibility, to make Parliament also more accountable. I mentioned it, therefore. Parliament meets, it disrupted. Just think at what the constitutional concept was of our Parliament. That ministers were accountable. Now ministers would decide when the Parliament would meet, what would they pass. If there is a disruption, then they can pass any law by so-called voice vote. So I think we need some basic reforms which can hold the government accountable. Sorry, I mean, this is not an easy question but hopefully, today that we have the people who have the ability to do what Amitabh Kant said, would also enlarge their, what you might say, their work to cover Parliament, to cover different ministries. There are some organizations have come up. We have Right to Information Act. Why can't this Right to Information Act be applied not only to ask questions, but why can't we say that each ministry, whatever policy they have announced, which on a weekly basis, they would put it on the, I mean, today there is a website, every ministry has it on their website to say how much they have implemented. But thank you for a very important question that you have asked.
All right, so let's move on to the next question. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, I want to speak from the MSME point of view. See, all MSME, India is a big country, and we have thousands and thousands of MSME. It's unlike US, they are large-scale industries or job seekers. But MSME cannot get properly funded. You talk about banks, they would maximum fund you 1 crore, 2 crore or 3 crore rupees. The cost of employing people, the cost of material, everything has gone skyrocketed. And MSMEs cannot scale their operations because of that. And this is a big problem with them. They cannot have venture capitalists coming to small towns. They cannot get access to venture capitalists. So what is government doing for them? Because it's a very, very big gap to fill.
Now again, I don't have an answer to the question that you have asked, because you are absolutely right that we can do so much and we do so little for MSMEs.
But how do they scale up? They have the vision, they have the knowledge.
You hold them accountable.
But
why don't you tell your, you know, why don't you constitute a group of people, and today you have people who ask ministers questions. Now let us say why it's not being done. Because we have the resources, we have the ability, and we always say we are doing it, but we don't. So on the 70th year of India's independence, on 15th of August, why don't we launch a program of holding ministers accountable who have announced policies for MSMEs? You can constitute a group, some startup, form a startup, which will say that it was announced, this was done, to be done. What happened?
Thank you.
All right, so let's take one last question. Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. This is Vivek here. So, sir, you talked about GST being implemented, and definitely GST is a very good thing for the nation, and apparently it looks like the way forward towards it. But a major section of the Indian economy is manufacturers, entrepreneurs, traders, who've been doing business in a books of accounts, which is handwritten, and been looked after by
the chartered. Sir, if I can request you to keep the mic a little closer. Yes.
And then it's been handled by the chartered accountants. Now, with GST happening, everything is digitalized. The invoicing needs to be done on the system, and it needs to be uploaded. The government needs to be made aware of everything. So how, as young entrepreneurs myself, can enable these other our elderlies or people who are doing business the traditional way, or how the government can support them in terms of bringing that education of being more GST friendly? Because I believe GST is an amazing system which traditional business houses have been unable to adopt, understanding the fact that 14 windows of taxes have gone out and only one taxation system has come in, but still they have not got used to the fact that they'll have to do it everything in an IT enabled process, and they're not educated enough, or they're not willing to change or willing to adopt. So how can we enable them?
No, I think it will take time. The ministry, the finance minister has also said that it will take some time. This is the beginning. And it's much better, GST is much better than interstate taxes. It's much better than different taxes on, you know, different commodities by different, you know, that you are transferring some commodity somewhere and it will have a different tax in one state, another tax there, then the toll gates and all that. So it's a very important move, extremely desirable move, but it will take time. And the government at least has announced just now that they are in consultation with all the state governments, see what can be done. And one of the more important issues to my mind is the multiple rates that we have, and which over a period of time also needs to be reviewed. Why similar products have two different rates? And can we simplify the procedure, simplification of the procedure and the rate system, if we can go beyond the Indian mentality to make it as complicated as we can? I think this is the most important move that would strengthen the growth prospects of India. And over a period of time, this government has announced its intention to make sure that GST actually works. But it will take time. Let us give at least, say, 18 months or 2 years.
All right then, so well, on that note, ladies and gentlemen, we call it a wrap to this session as well. Let's have a huge round of applause to thank Dr. Bimal Jalan for his valuable presence.
patents. Okay.
And thank you very much, sir, for sharing your valuable thoughts. I'm going to request Ms. Ritu Maria to please present a token of gratitude to Dr. Bimal Jalan for his valuable presence with us this morning.